Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, some of you might have heard that there has been declared a year of faith. And for those of you who have not yet heard, it is my pleasant duty to tell you that there has been declared a year of faith by the successor of St. Peter, Pope Benedict XVI, the Vicar of Christ, for this year which began on Thursday, the 11th of October, 2012. The occasion for making this declaration is the 50th anniversary of the opening of the Second Vatican Council. So we are 50 years on from this enormous event that we are still trying to understand and implement faithfully. Councils come along rarely in the Church. There was another one in 1870 and another one 500 years ago. So it is a rare privilege and pleasure to participate in the Church at such an interesting period in the way in which the Holy Spirit guides the Church from century to century. And in each age, the Lord rises up from among us, one who will stand in the place of Peter as the Vicar of Christ. And in our age, Pope Benedict XVI is just that man. He is just the one that the Holy Spirit rests upon to discern the signs of the times in which we live. Now, I said that the 50th anniversary of the opening of the Council was the occasion for the declaration of the Year of Faith, but it is not the reason. The reason is what Pope Benedict has discerned in the world today, and which is what we can all discern if we look closely, and it is a grave crisis of faith. Not only here in the United States, where it is already very advanced, but especially in the heartland of Christendom, in the old European countries, where the churches stand empty and locked up or turned into restaurants and coffee shops and libraries and museums, where the seminaries stand empty, turned into apartments, where the religious orders are closing for lack of vocations. Crisis of faith, where people do not marry and have children, where they do not live in any way recognizably like a people that has been redeemed by the great coming of the Messiah, Jesus Christ. In this country, in this week, two statistics were revealed. The one is that for the first time in its history, Protestant Christians are no longer the majority. And the second statistic that was revealed this week is that the fastest growing religion in the United States is atheism. We're living in a profound crisis of faith. And this crisis is what the Pope wants to draw our attentions to. The wonderful gift of faith, which is not a gift that we received simply at our baptism, and then we never have to look at it again. We can always just put on our badge whenever we get dressed, you know, like a lapel badge. Christian. The gift of faith is much more than a label. It's much more than a list of dogmas or doctrines. It's much more even than a list of commandments, like we heard in today's gospel. The faith is something a lot more. Like the writer of the Epistle to the Hebrews says, it is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates the soul and the spirit, the reflections and the thoughts of the heart. The gift of the faith is the gift of God Himself in Jesus of Nazareth. The Lord who made us, who knows our thoughts, who longs for us to respond to Him, has answered all the desires of our heart. It is a historical fact, the coming of the Messiah, Jesus. This is the gift of faith. God gives us Himself. This is why the day of our baptism, when we are received into the dynamic of this gift, when we are transformed into the body of Christ, is a greater day than the day of our birth. I'm sure we love celebrating our birthdays. I do too. But the day of our baptism is a greater day yet. Our parents, when they gave us life at birth, they gave us something that we know will end. It's finite. It's limited. It's the only thing surer than taxes is death. And we know it's limited also in terms of height, good looks, intelligence. Old age comes, sickness comes. So it is, at best, a mixed celebration, our birthday, is it not? But there is another day when we received a new birth, a rebirth, when we were reborn in Christ, the day of our baptism, when we received, by the grace of our parents who presented us at the baptismal font and our sponsors who vouched for us, we received a life that is unlimited, that is eternal. We are made to live in happiness forever with God. No death, no disease, no limits. The greatest gift is the gift of faith, because we receive nothing other than God Himself in Jesus. In the baptismal font, we put away this life with its limits. We put away sin, we put away death, and we put on Christ. What we receive, that gift, is the Word Himself, the Word of God. As the letter to the Hebrews says, it is God's Word that is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. We receive the Word of God Himself, spoken into our inmost being, where He takes up dwelling within us. God dwells within us. This is the gift of faith. But God is not just a wrapped gift or a list like the commandments or the doctrines of the church. He is a person. It's very personal, the gift of faith. It's no badge at all. It is a relationship. And like any other relationship, it requires certain fundamentals. No relationship in your life would survive a day if there was no communication, if you never communicated. You could not have a relationship. It is a fundamental part of a relationship that you communicate. So the consequences of this year of the faith for each one of us here is to take upon ourselves practical resolutions that can make this year bear fruit for the sake of the church and for the sake of those who have lost their faith or are losing their faith or who are far away from the church. These practical things include what I've just mentioned. Relationship requires communication. Number one, prayer. How can we celebrate the gift of the faith if we are not prayerful people on a daily basis? It is not enough to come and check the box once a week at Holy Mass. No relationship can survive on that. We need to be involved in communication. Yourself and the gift that you have received, who is a person, the Word of God. The second thing that any relationship requires is a certain study of the other, a certain attentiveness or curiosity to the other. For those of you who are married or in love, you know that this curiosity is the most natural thing in the world. You want to know, what is your favorite color? What do you love eating? Do you have any allergies? What was your favorite book or movie? Are you a morning person? All these questions that go far beyond labels, they go far beyond dogmas and lists. They go to this curiosity, which our first reading speaks about. I prayed, and prudence was given to me, this gift of the Holy Spirit. I pleaded, and the spirit of wisdom was given to me. Now, wisdom in Greek is Sophia, like the church Santa Sophia in Constantinople, in Istanbul. It's not dedicated to a saint called Sophia. It's dedicated to holy wisdom. Because throughout the Old Testament, wisdom is seen as prefiguring people's understanding of the Word of God. Now, the word in Greek for Word of God is logos. And it's a male word, a masculine word, whereas Sophia is a feminine word. And so throughout the first reading we hear about wisdom, she this and she that and her this and her that. And it talks in the feminine pronouns because Sophia is a feminine noun. But the reality is the same. Sophia, wisdom in the Old Testament, is the word, the logos in the New Testament. It is the gift of God Himself, which is faith, our greatest gift. Now, if it is truly our greatest gift, and it is, then we should live accordingly. Then we should live as the writer of the first reading says. I preferred this gift to scepter and throne. In other words, if somebody were to come and say, if you would give up your faith, we'll give you the monarchy. You could be the next king of I won't name a country, some country. You would prefer your faith. You give up scepter and throne. The writer deems riches nothing in comparison with wisdom. No priceless gem compares to this gift of the faith. All gold is like a little sand. Silver, mire. I loved the gift of faith beyond even health. I would willingly lose my health for the gift of the faith. And many martyrs have. The splendor of faith never yields. We need to ask ourselves how we value the gift of faith. Do we prefer it to any other thing? Because it is our faith which gets us through the journey of life. It is our faith that will get us into eternal beatitude in heaven. Faith sustains us to the end. Do we value it as our greatest treasure? Or are we like the rich young man in today's gospel? He was very willing, very knowledgeable, kept all the commandments, came running to the Lord, knelt before Him, called Him good teacher, recognized that He was good like God, for He is God. And yet there was one thing He could not do. He could not value His relationship with Christ above any other thing. He had one thing that He valued higher, and it was His riches. And the Lord diagnosed the spiritual problem. And He said, very well, go and relinquish these things that you cling to above the gift of faith, and come follow Me. But he couldn't see it. He didn't see that it was a trade-off between the Lord Himself and His riches, because who would doubt what to do in such a situation? And so he went away sad, but hopefully a temporary sadness, as we do when we make such decisions. For the Lord looked at him and loved him, and that is a love that transforms us. So we can hope that the rich young man came back again when he realized that it was a trade-off for Christ Himself, the gift of faith. Peter realized this when he says, even though he's amazed, they're besides themselves, they're overwhelmed at what the Lord has said. He says, but Lord, we, to follow You, have left homes, fishing boats, nets, farms, fathers, mothers, brothers, sisters. For You, we've clung to nothing in comparison to You. And the Lord says, yes, and I give You My word, My logos. It will make its home within you. And this is a word that will recompense you a hundredfold, homes, mothers, fathers, fishing boats, not only in the world to come, but in this present age. And I'm sure there are many of you, I hear you in the confessional witnessing to this, you witness to the sacrifices you've made, sometimes for your husbands or your wives, for your children, for your parents, but oftentimes for Almighty God, because in the tribunal of mercy, we confront those choices like the rich young man, where we give up the fountain of everlasting life for leaky cisterns, where we trade in the most precious thing, our faith, for tinsel and glass beads. You witness to the sacrifices you make then when you turn back to the Lord. It's a beautiful, encouraging thing to a priest, because priests too are called to give up certain things to follow the Lord, just as Peter said. And your faith is an encouragement to my faith, and I hope vice versa, because we are given to one another in the faith. The faith is a relationship. It's intensely personal. God comes to take up his dwelling within you, more intimate than that, and it has consequences for one another, for the support that we offer to each other. Of course, we all have experiences also of our lack of faith, of our littleness of faith. We don't doubt, like the rich young man, that God is great and his commandments are worthy. But we can't find it in ourselves to measure up. We're too little. And that discourages us, but it should not. The gift of faith is a gift, not from us to God, but from God to us. We receive this gift from the greatest giver, and we can never doubt that it will be sufficient. We only doubt when we forget and we think that it is our gift to God. All God wants is your willingness to receive this gift, because he will not violate your freedom. So much does he respect you. But once you have opened your heart, that crack, and you have opened the door to him, he will give you that gift of faith. And it will never be lacking. Sometimes, yes, we pray with St. Augustine. I believe, Lord, help thou my unbelief. And he does. Brothers and sisters, as this year of faith begins, let us commit ourselves to celebrating this wonderful gift that we've received, over and above every gift, including life itself. A greater gift that we received at our baptism is eternal life, the gift of faith, the wisdom of God that penetrates within our soul, knowing our every innermost thoughts, the intimacy of that relationship by which God's word comes to dwell among us, so that we will prefer nothing to the faith, so that we will be courageous and encourage others, inflame them in their love for God with the two things, the two practical means by which we can celebrate the year of faith: prayer and the study of God, because every relationship requires communication and curiosity. Let's take it upon ourselves in the year of faith to augment our prayer, the relationship aspect of the word of God that dwells within us, and also the study of God. I commend to you in the year of the faith a marvelous work. We're celebrating 50 years of the council, and this is the final work of the council, the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Every one of you should have this year. It's not expensive, and it's a little bit daunting in its thickness. Well, this one's full of footnotes and things. But if you take a little morsel a day, a little bite a day, for a year, I assure you, you'll get through it. Just a few paragraphs. Know your faith. Know the one you love. And speak to him. And there is another form of the gospel, and that is the rosary. October is the month of the rosary, dear people. And the year of faith begins and ends in the month of the rosary. Let us take upon ourselves the mysteries of the life of Christ. Let us meditate them with Mary through her eyes, the one who knew him and loved him most intimately, so that we will draw near to the one who is himself the gift of faith, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.